begin with, I'm not a scientist, okay? Let me be very clear on that. I have my two masters, both not in science. One in finance, the other one is on theology. So I'm not a scientist. I'm just an aam aatmi like you, okay? So what am I doing here? When I got into college, I've got into a college which was full of atheists. The college council was of communists, and that was a fashion to be an atheist. So around 70-80% of my colleagues were atheists, and they had their study circles, etc., etc. And these deep questions have challenged me to my core when I was a student. And there began my inquiry of what is true, what is rational, what is logical. All that my parents taught me, are they true? Is it something that I can believe? And hence, I started from the scratch. So today what am I going to present you is the inquiry and what I'm finding in the whole thing. My inquiry is not over. I continue to understand. As many things develop around us, I continue to inquire. And that's the study that I'm going to present to you. When I say modern atheism, it's nothing modern about it. It's basically old wine in a new bottle. That's it. Because I don't know how many years since I passed out of my college. I need my wife to calculate that numbers. I think at least 25 years or so, I guess. I mean, if my guess is wrong, forget it. Forgive me. After so many years, as I look at it, the so-called modern atheism, there is hardly any change. Only the characters have changed. On those days, we were more to do with Karl Marx and stuff like that. Those guys have all gone. Now we have some new names that has come. But arguments have, unfortunately, not changed. It's almost the same. So then what is this all hangama about? What are these guys are doing? What's so big about what these guys are doing? Number one, big difference that I'm seeing from my earlier days of college, and now as I see the atheists in the internet, they're very aggressive, outspoken people. They ridicule belief system. In olden days, they never used to do that. They were polite in rebutting the faith of religious people to some extent, at least on public eyes. Today, they ridicule it and they propagate to ridicule it. Today's atheists have found this a great business as well, I suspect, because all of them have written some books and they aggressively promote their book. That seems to be a major motto to the extent that I understand in the difference between earlier days and now. There has been some reason for this resurgence of atheism suddenly in this modern world. One is, there is this religious terrorism, the fundamentalism that has been growing in our land. Not just in our land, across the globe. We have this jihadist and ISIS and all these people taking them as a model for religious faith. Atheists started making the propagation that this is how religion is all about. They are terrorists. And you can't believe them. That's how the line of argument goes in modern atheism. Unfortunately, these guys have not really looked into history. They have scant regard for history. You really look at history, the biggest terrorists in the world were atheists. You look at Hitler of Germany, he was an atheist. You look at Stalin of Russia, he was an atheist. You look at Mao, the China, he was an atheist. World has not seen greater terrorists than these people. So to that extent, this argument doesn't go. Even you look at the suicide bombers, as you look at ISIS and say that these are religious people. The massive suicide bombing so far ever done in history are done by Tamil Tigers. They were not religious people. They were rather fanatics for their language. So, in no way you can connect these aberrations to a religion and try to make a straw man and attack that straw man and say religious beliefs foment terrorism. That's far from the truth. So these modern atheists try to thrive on this particular aspect, because everybody is upset with these terrorism, and they say that, oh, that's because of religion, and hence religion is bad. That's how they try to portray, while that's not the truth. Rather, atheism foment terrorism in a big way. I'll tell you the reasons in a few minutes. Second thing is, there is a rising capitalism on the economy. That's my subject. I can talk about it. There is income level that has been increasing in the societies. In India also, we see that. And that brings about materialism and the mind of materialistic worldview into the people that we so invest. Very soon, we are seeing that, going to see that in India as well. This materialism breeds a kind of, I don't care, agnosticism or atheism very, very easily. And these modern atheists really look into target this kind of people who are on the borders. Thirdly, there is a reluctance to accept morality or moral principles to themselves in this world. That's why we see a lot of people coming out with saying that I'm a gay, or I'm a lesbian, I'm a free sexual, I'm bisexual, that, this. It's all going on and on, and they just don't want to live in any kind of moral values. And this has actually made many people go into the camp of atheism, because they are absolutely open for these things, because they feel it's man's choice. It's your freedom. You do what you want. What is good for you, it's good for you. That's it. You don't need to care what others think about it. And that's sort of making many people look that as an option to live their licensed life. Dawkins once said that people who believe in God, they fear darkness. And one of the mathematical professors of Oxford University replied to him, saying, people who believed in atheism, they fear light. And that's fact. All right. And these new modern atheists, they call themselves, they brand themselves, because it's in a marketing world, they brand themselves as brights. That's a new word that you will get to hear very soon. Brights. And they wanted to sort of brand it that way. That's how even the homosexuals have branded themselves as gays. They don't like you calling them homosexuals. They rather call themselves as gays. And now we all fall into the trap. We all fell into that trap. We all call them gays only. It is consciously branded to give a kind of aura around it. And this is the new terminology that they are building up, brights, which means to say those who are believing in atheism are bright people. They are scientific people. They are the ones who know science. And every intelligent person is a bright person. And there is a lot of campaign going around, even among children, to be enrolling into this bright category. This is pure marketing technique. There are four horsemen, as they are called, into the modern atheism. The one is Christopher Hitchens. He has died. The second one is Daniel Dennett. Third one is Richard Hawkins. And the fourth one is Sam Harris. They together are forming the central axiom of modern atheism. They have written books, and there were a lot of interviews together around them. If I may say, their gospel truth is the book of Richard Dawkins, which Johnny mentioned, The God Delusion. And they consider that to be the gospel truth. And interestingly, if you read that book, since he is a scientist in Oxford University, you expect to have a lot of science that is coming into this book. If you really look into that book, there is neither science nor logic coming up in that book. While he goes through some of the hypotheses of science, we will see that as we go along. It is not a scientific book at all. It is written with single mind focus of attacking Christianity and Christian theistic God. That's what the single most focus. And that's what his interviews talks about. That's what his book talk about. That's what everything that he's talking about. I jokingly said, even for Dawkins to sell his book, he has to use the word God. Otherwise, nobody would have bought it, right? So he is using that to sell his book, and his book is all about against Christianity. And what he does, the methodology that he does is, over the ages, the best arguments that supporting the existence of God, he picks them up. And then he brings in, as a couple of slides that Johnny has shown, some of these hypotheses, be it mutations and string theory or multiverse theory, all that he put it across because common man doesn't understand that much. And then at the end of it, he would say, with all this, almost centrally, that is his fourth chapter, which is his central argument, almost certainly that there is no God. Are ye kidhar se aaya? If you really look into that, there is no way, that logical deduction that you can make. Absolutely no. We will see that in a little while. Their biggest allegation against Christian faith or theistic faith of Christianity. I'm going to stand for Christian faith, theistic faith. I can't stand for other believers of God. So Christian theistic faith. The biggest grouse against that which modern atheists raise is that these people's belief are nothing but faith without any proof. You got that two word? Faith without any proof. All right. So we will start from there because that's the basic idea about the people. Okay. So what is proof? What is faith and proof are? So definition of faith, Richard Dawkins bring about by quoting Bertrand Russell. And Bertrand Russell has said that your faith is like a teapot that is orbiting around the sun somewhere between Mars and Earth, somewhere in the outer space. This is a quotation of Bertrand Russell. And they said, Dawkins, Richard Dawkins in his book, God Delusion, he says, this is what your faith is. Now, what is he trying to allude with that statement? Number one, this is an imaginary idea which you can't prove. There is no proof for this at all. That's what he's trying to say, number one. Number two, he also inbuilt in that statement saying, all that atheists saying are with proof. You see, all that we are saying is with proof because all that we are talking about is from science. And science is completely a proven thing, and hence, atheistic position is right, is what he is trying to say. Now, philosophically, if you look at it, the philosophical argument that he is taking here is something called unprovability. There is a technical terminology that it has, unfalsifiability. You don't need to worry about it. It's easy to understand unprovability. Now, what is he saying is, a teapot orbiting around sun, between Mars and Earth, in the sky, you can't prove it. How can you prove it? Can you? You can't. The same thing is with God. It is unprovable. That's what he's trying to say. Now, you just ask that question back to him. Richard Dawkins believe something called steady state theory, which means the entire universe were as it was from eternity. There is no beginning for the universe. It was always there. Matter was there. Energy was there. Time was there. Can you put that under the unprovability test, please? Can you? Isn't it fair to ask him to prove his theory? No answer. Very quietly. These guys have only art of asking questions, not answering questions. He just brushed that aside. The yardstick that he is putting up for us to answer is the same yardstick he also has to prove because he has a theory. And absolutely no way that he can prove it. The other way around. We are talking about a God, uncreated. And believing that such a God created earth or universe is far more logical than saying that a space or a matter which is uncaused. Our logic is far more superior even in that test. What is the definition of proof? Now let's touch that matter. What is proof, by the way? You would be surprised to know, in scientific world, there is no subject other than mathematics that works on proof. I'm making a big statement. Listen to me. Other than in mathematics, there is no scientific streams in this world which is working on proof that can be proved. Mathematics can be proved with the basic axioms that you have and running through a way of logic. You can bring a proof. Of course, there are some people proving otherwise also. There is one gentleman called Kurt Gödel, a German mathematician, who said that there is something called undecidable statement in mathematics too. But then I just leave him aside. By and large, all the scientists, it's not my assertion, all the scientists in the world agree to this fact that only in mathematics that you can get proof, you can prove a theorem in itself. Then what about other sciences? What other sciences call proof is a kind of relative or informal sense of word proof. Informal sense of the word proof, which means they gather evidences which indicates the reality. And that's what is informal proof, which they call it proof. Okay? They gather informal evidences. And that evidences together they see logically and figure out, is that pointing to a reality? Just for an example, there was a murder happened somewhere here. How do you prove it? You will raise that guy and kill him again, is it? So that you can see it and you can prove it? You can't. What do you do then? You gather evidences, right? You gather evidences. And that evidences you put together. And then evidences could be from forensic department, evidences could be historical, evidences could be observational, different disciplines you have. From where you gather evidences and then put that evidences together and then you form your opinion. And that's the informal proof. This is accepted in the scientific world. And this is the only way the science can move ahead. There is no proof that you can do science otherwise. This is the informal proof that we are talking about. Now, if that is what proof is, even in the scientific world, that is exactly what we are also talking in the Christian world. Our belief system is not blind at all. The belief in the living God, the belief in Lord Jesus Christ, the belief in His death and His resurrection, there are informal proof to prove that in a term sense of evidences that you can gather. It could be from history, it could be from various sources, we will discuss it later. So we are very much in line of scientific methodology as far as our faith is concerned. Now you ask that question to atheist. Has he got that? We will see some of them. Unfortunately, they don't have any. We will see some of them very soon. So what we will do now is, next few minutes that we have, the remaining of the session, we will divide it into three. The evidences of modern science, we will see a couple of them. Then after that, we will see evidences presented by atheists. And thirdly, and finally, we will look at evidences presented by the Christian worldview. All right. You're with me up to this? Are you okay? Yeah? All right. Okay. So let's look at first one. Evidences used by modern scientists. Now, modern scientists really exploded in the 16th and 17th century. That's the time where tremendous findings in the scientific world that has happened. You have Newton, who has come up with his laws of motion and gravity. Kepler, that's talked about planetary motion. Galileo, that talked about basic relativity in physics, which has happened to be the basis of Einstein's relativity theory later. Robert Boyle, who has done wonderful work in chemistry and who is called as father of modern science. You have James Clerk Maxwell, who has done amazing works and findings in electromagnetic theory, and he is called as father of electromagnetic theory. You have Francis Bacon, who has found the method, the father of scientific methodology. All these people in those centuries, they are the ones who really took science to where it is today. Path-breaking findings that they have done during the 16th and 17th century. And you know what? None of them that I listed now are atheists. They were atheists. All of them were believers of God. No, not that over. All of them believed in the God of the Bible. They believed in Lord Jesus Christ and the redemption through the death and resurrection of Lord Jesus Christ. These are scientists which the scientific world revere. They are the ones whom the scientific world still look up to. Lord of their theories are the basis of growth that you see in the modern science today. You have the biggest scientific institutions in the world. Some of them I've just listed out here. Oxford University, University of Cambridge, Yale University, Richard Dawkins is one of these universities in Oxford University where he is doing the science. These universities were formed for the purpose of the glory of God. It is written on their walls. Even today you can go and see it. These universities are formed that they will go and search through scientific means the courts and the laws which God has kept in the universe so that God would be glorified. And sitting in those universities, somebody is telling, there is no God. How sad it is. It is, they all knew the difference between a mechanism and the agent. For example, Newton has found this law of gravity. Now, he has found the law of gravity and he was so thrilled. Had it been Dawkins, he would have said, "Whoa, whoa, hooray, there is no God. I found the mechanism of the world, the gravity." That's not what Newton did. He had some more sense. You know what he did? He wrote one of the classics of scientific world, Principia Mathematica. And in that he has written in the preface itself, "For the glory of God, I present this to you." He believed in God. They knew finding a mechanism is different from knowing God, who is the agent of that mechanism. It's like jet engine, which was found by Frank Whittle. Now, after many years, somebody suddenly forgot about Frank Whittle and all. You found jet engine and wow, what a law of physics this is. Hey, look at the matter. Look at these things that are around it, the physics around it, and the law that I found, how it is working. Now you can't believe Frank Whittle. I found what it is, the mechanism. Stupidity, isn't it? Just because you found the mechanism of the engine doesn't mean you rule out the one who created it. Mechanism and agency are different. That's the biggest cardinal mistake these people are making. Scientists of name of this kind, they knew what they're finding. They were finding the laws God has put in this universe. Who asked to do this science? Science is asked to be done by God himself. When God created Adam and Eve, he told to Adam, "You name these creatures out in the world." What is science doing? Science is doing only naming. Naming means to find it, understand it, and name them. That's what science is doing. Lot of naming is happening in this scientific world. This is naming. It started by God's express commandment. It's God who asked to do science that people will understand and get into that wonderment of God's amazing wisdom and glorify him. C.S. Lewis once said, "Men became scientific because they expected law in nature." They expected law in nature because they knew that there is a God. There is a lawgiver. They expected law in nature because they knew that there is a lawgiver. And that's why they were driving science. This poor man, Richard Dawkins, calls Christian scientists as lazy people. I pity him. Instead of he doing this lazy thing to make profits, go do some science, man. These are the people, he's not driven to do science because he is driven to do making money. I mean, obviously, I can understand that. That's okay. But don't call Christian scientists lazy. These are the ones relentlessly go on, motivated to find the laws of the universe. And they do that because they know there are laws in this universe and because they know there is a lawgiver in the universe. Richard Dawkins called this silly. Say, if I go home and I see my wife baked a cake, you know, a three-layer cake, beautiful, nicely done chocolate cake she's made, what should be my question to her? Pardon? What is so special today? Very good. I think you got that question. Very good, very good. Experience speaks. Yeah. You know what Dawkins will ask? What is the chemistry of this cake? What is the physics of this cake? And then he will find out, oh, this is in this temperature that this has been baked, and this is the mechanism that which will come. Hey, what is so special is silly. Why do you ask that question? If my wife explains the mechanism of making that cake and the ingredients of that cake in the name of physics and chemistry, you're satisfied, is it? I'll have to take it to the psychiatrist then. The biggest question in there is why? What is so special? Why? And Dawkins call it silly. How silly one can be in the name of science. Science runs with that question of why. If you don't have that question, you can't be a scientist. How can Richard Dawkins has thrown his science away? That's a very, very important question. That's not a silly question. Now, modern science run with these evidences. All these people who have found amazing things in this world, the laws of the universe, they found things which are with evidences. You know, when apple falls, it comes down, it doesn't go up. And that's the evidence that he has gathered. Did you get what I'm trying to say? They have gathered evidences. And those evidences make them look at God who created that law in this universe. And that's how they advance their sciences. This is true science. Even today, this is true science, which works, which try to find out the laws in universe and then gather the evidences for it and then work out the reasonable conclusion out of it. So that is modern science. Don't ever misunderstand this science with Richard Dawkins brands. Very, very different. He is not part of this scientific world. It's a very different world. It's an atheistic world. So the scientist in Richard Dawkins, I see him very different from the atheist in Richard Dawkins. World knows him as an atheist man. And that's where I will see him at all. Real science is this one, where you figure out the laws of universe and then figure out with evidences what it all leads up to. Now let's look at atheism. Atheistic evidences. What are the evidences these atheists are presenting? We will look at five of them. Okay. I'm sure I'm going to overshoot the time. You're okay? Okay. All right. Maybe. Let me try to make it faster. Okay. So there are five of them. We will pick it up from Richard Dawkins and maybe from other classics of atheism. The first one is steady state theory. We will go a little faster. Don't worry about these themes, because I'm also an Aam Aadmi. So I'll make it in a way that you will understand, okay? That's the way I understand. So we'll make it'll be easy for you. So don't switch off your mind. Don't worry, it'll be easy, okay? Now, steady state theory is found, or rather proposed, that's the right word to use, by Sir Hermann Bondi and Thomas Gold. You don't need to write it down because everything is there in the note. I've given you the full note, okay? So you don't need to worry about it. 9-page note is given to you, okay? So these guys have proposed this, and then it was Fred Foyle, another man, who has made it very, very popular. So what it says to say is, universe is always been in a steady state. That's what steady state is. Utna hi hai. Universe was always in a steady state. It was never made, nor it was ever going to be finished. Then came along the thermodynamic principle, whereby the second law of thermodynamics tells us that the entropy, or the entropy, that means the depreciation in our language, if you can say, will increase in the systems. Then atheists didn't know what to do. So then, if it is increasing in the system, then they have added into it saying, if there is entropy that is increasing, that is depreciation if it is increasing, then there is a creation also is happening in the universe. So that as much as it is getting depreciated, so much as new creation is happening, and hence there is a steady state in the universe, and that is what is called steady state theory. Frankly speaking, I was thoroughly surprised, as much as many, many scientists that I am reading and hearing, that this man picked up steady state theory to prove his entire book. Because steady state theory is discarded by the scientist almost world over. Because there is a Big Bang theory that has come afterwards. And when the Big Bang theory came, where they said from an atomic egg there was a big explosion, and from there the whole creation had happened, so there was a moment of starting, is what it said. Of course, Big Bang has not explained where that atomic egg came from, so that's a different story. But after Big Bang theory has come, steady state theory was discarded. And much more than that, after Big Bang theory was found, the proposers also said, you would find background microwave radiation around the globe if this is true. And 1960, 1965, even this background microwave radiation was found. So, by and large, the entire scientific world has discarded this steady state theory. They rather go with a Big Bang theory. And here is a man picking up this old discarded steady state theory and coming up to prove his point. Why is he doing? He's doing because of compulsion. If he said there was a Big Bang, he has to agree that there was a beginning. And then he has to agree and answer where that energy came from, where that matter came from. He has to answer those questions. Instead, he went to this old theory of steady state and said, universe was always there. I mean, so, I don't know. Science will find it. That's his favorite statement. We will find it. We will find it. We are working hard. We are putting our sleeves up and we are working hard. We will find it. Come on. This is not a scientific world. I'm compelled to say, Richard Dawkins is not an honest scientist. Because just to prove his atheism advanced, he is picking up things which are discarded by scientists. To that extent, he is not going along with science at all. It is completely discarded scientific stuff, I mean, theorems that has been coming up. And so this atheism, modern atheism, is not based on science at all. That's the biggest point that I want to put it up front. They are not science-oriented people. Rather, I would say they are anti-scientific people. Then the second one. Multiverse theory. Now, multiverse theory is making waves not only because Richard Dawkins, also because of Hawkins, who died. He also has started talking about it, and there is some paper clippings that you would have seen that perhaps his last writings could be about multiverse and things like that. Okay, so I was searching, what is this stuff all about? To make it very simple, without technical jargons. First of all, it's a hypothesis. Hypothesis means something where you have not found your evidences. That's what it hypothesis is. You're with me? So it's just a proposition. This is the proposal. There is no evidences yet gathered. So first of all, this is an hypothesis. Steady state theory also was a hypothesis without evidences. Just imagine, these are the atheists who tells us you need proof. And they are carrying out hypotheses which has no proof, forget about proof, no evidences at all. And this is another one. So, there was an argument in the classic writers of philosophy that suppose somebody walks into a jungle and found a watch in the jungle. What's the conclusion is? The conclusion should be that this watch has got fantastic physical mechanisms. And it has so much of material used into it. And to all probability, that this watch should have been made of its own by chance. And that's how the whole thing would be. Okay? So or the other option is that this watch is found in that jungle, which means there was somebody intelligent was there in the jungle who had this watch with him, and there is an intelligent designer behind making of this complex watch. That's the other way around it. So atheists decided to take the first argument. The first argument is there is a watch and the watch has got complex mechanisms. We are not able to explain how it has come about. And but it's by chance, I mean, we don't know. Then the Christian theists and the logics and the philosophical logics, they picked it up and asked, look, if a watch has to be made of its own, what is the probability? That goes to mathematics, the probability theory. And they found this is unbelievably, I mean, it's so much that it is impossible. Then, in that background, I'm making it very simple for you to understand, comes this multiverse theory, where they take this watch and go to a factory of watches and then say, this watch is among the millions of watches here. Okay? So to that extent, the denominator is increased. It's not that one watch, it's millions of watch. Hence, the probability could be more. How do you like it? How do you like it? Universe, they are not able to explain how it has come about, how this fine-tuning of universe has come. So they went on to say that there are millions of other universes in bubbles, and this is just one among them, and hence, hey, multiverse theory has answered all your questions of origin. they have not understood the what they're trying to do. They also have said all these multi-universes, their constants are different. It is different from the earth that we are living. They said that because otherwise we will come back and say that, oh, if that is true, then that's again showing the designer. So they didn't want that. So they said that the constants are different. So that means different millions of universes of different constants all around. It's not that asking the same question, how each of these, it will not be a probability to gather then. It should be a probability of each. So your probability is going millions of times more. Are you getting? Slightly? It makes no sense at all. They can't answer that question and escape that probability by proposing this multiverse theory. Don Page is a theoretical physicist at the University of Alberta. This man has worked with Richard Dawkins in Oxford and co-authored many papers with him. You see what he is saying about the multiverse theory? Multiverse theory has not been fully formulated nor has any credible evidences. Even if it gets fully formulated one day and finds some credible explanations through evidences, it doesn't rule out God who created the universe. And there is another one from Oxford mathematician Roger Penrose. I'm not reading it out. You can read at home. The brilliant scientists understand what this guy is trying to do. And they are trying to tell us, this is not going to work. This is just expanding the problem. And there is no shred of evidences whatsoever. Forget about seeing. That's proof. I'm not going the proof. I'm going to evidences. No shred of evidences. And forget about evidences. This is not even formulated yet. It is still on the storyboard. Okay? And that's the one that he is taking up and talking about, saying, hey, everything is proved. We know now where the universe is coming from. Utter, I don't know, I don't have word. My wife has told me don't use the word stupid, so I can't use this. I don't know what to call it. This is dishonesty to the core by a scientist. All right. Then we leave multiverse theory and we go to chance. This has been a popular one, and this continues to be a popular one on chance, although Dawkins say that I don't believe in chance, but and that's why he went to the steady state theory. Now we have to deal with them because you will see a lot of atheists on this chance. They say chance has created the whole thing. Now, what is chance? Is it a being? It is no thing. Nothing. It's not a thing. Am I right? It's not a thing. It's a no thing. Nothing. Has it got the power to create something? Causal power? Has it got the power to cause something? If you flip a coin and try to see head or tails, and if it head call comes 50% and tails come 50%, you call it, there is a 50% chance. That's what chance we call generally. Okay. What does it mean? Has the chance flipped the coin? No. Has the chance decided head or tail has to fall? No. Chance there only means to say, it just read what has happened. explanation. That's all. It doesn't have the power to create. It doesn't have causal power at all. Then in a place, I mean, if I can call it a place, there is no space, no time, no matter, no energy. What on the basis that you're going to calculate chance? What are you explaining? I mean, are you getting what I'm trying to say? This is ridiculous. Chance doesn't work at all. Philosophically, this is just not possible. Roger Penrose, another Oxford University professor, he called this, if this has to happen, the chance or the probability of this is 1 is to 10 raised to 123, which means you put a 0 point, then you put 122 zeros and a 1. That's the chance. We normally say that there is 10% chance. I mean, doctor tells us there is 10% chance to survive. You said, Khadam. You have to 10% chance. And if you say 1% chance, or a 1% chance, kya hone wala hai? Kuch hone wala nahi. And then doctor say that there is a chance. You know what? What the chance? 0.00000122 and 1. And you will be very happy, isn't it? Oh, what a... Mathematically, this is improbable. This is what chance is. Fred Hoyle, he was an atheist earlier and turned to atheism. He has commented on it and he has put another one. The probability of cellular lives arising from non-living matter was about 1 in 10 raised to 40,000. 0.039,999 and then there is a 1. And that's the chance. And then he said, with an example for us to understand, that this is like a big tornado happened in the junkyard. And in that tornado, in that junkyard, it suddenly assembled a Boeing 747 jet. He said, that's the chance. He gave a lot of them because it was a junkyard. So there was a matter there. And in the universe, there was no junkyard. There was no matter. What chance were these guys are talking about? Richard Dawkins picked this Hoyle's comment. 747 Boeing. So this is how they do. This is very cunning of them. Extremely cunning people. He picked that up. And then he put something else. Some one or two scientific hypotheses. So that common man will not understand what is that hypothesis is. So that they will see, are you 747? Oh, that is answered. Dawkins have answered. Dawkins have answered. I have heard that in the internet. People saying, have you not read Dawkins answered this? What answer? You know what Dawkins said? He said that, it is in his chapter 4, the central argument. If this is what the argument you guys are telling me, then my question is, who created God? Amazing. What a question. What a scientific question. Poor Dawkins. I mean, I can pardon him because he is not of logic and philosophy. I can pardon him. He has not understood the categories. There is a category mistake here. He is assuming in his question that God is created being. That's his assumption. He very clearly assumes that God is a created being. That's why this question becomes meaningful. No wonder his book is God Delusion. Created gods are delusion. There is no doubt about it. We also have no, I mean, we don't, I mean, we also don't say no about it. That's true. Created gods are delusional. But Mr. Dawkins, he has not understood that the theistic God of the Bible is not a created being. He is uncaused. He is not being caused at all. Uncreated, uncaused, everlasting being is what being revealed of this God. And then this question doesn't mean anything. It is just like somebody is saying, can you create a square circle? How intelligent that question is. That's not a category question. That's in philosophy, you call it a nonsense question. This is a nonsense question. You, in the youth meetings, you hear these kinds of questions sometimes. Can God is so powerful? Can he create a rock which he cannot lift because he is powerful? You didn't get that. God is so powerful, he can do anything. So he, can you create a rock which he cannot lift? Wow, what an intelligent question. That is a stupid question. It is called nonsense question. It's not a category question at all. Uncreated God, uncaused God, eternal God. He is not created, he is not caused, and this question has no validity at all. Now, my question back to Dawkins, it looks like he has a problem of believing in anything eternal and uncaused. That's the issue. I'm an atheist. I can't believe anything eternal and uncaused. But what is he doing in his theory? Matter is uncaused eternal. Energy, uncaused eternal. So he can believe on a matter and an energy. And for the books, even today scientists know what this energy is. Even today, scientists doesn't know what this energy is. They know evidences of energy. They know the characters of energy. They don't know what this energy is. And this fellow believes that this energy and matter is uncaused, eternal. And he looks at and says that, hey, your belief is not right. He is in a metaphysics world. Metaphysics means beyond the physical world. We are also in a metaphysical world. Our belief system is far more logical than the atheistic worldview of this absolutely. All right. Now we will go to fourth theory of them. Evidences of them that they produce is theory of evolution and natural selection. Again, Darwin's theory of evolution and natural selection. This is a hypothesis. Let me tell that once again. It is just a hypothesis. It has not gathered evidences at all to bring it to a level where we can see and believe, yes, there is some proof. At least subjective proof. No, you would be surprised because all of us have learned it in our school books. All our school books have got it. And of course, our school books are generally copied from West, so it's normal. And unfortunately, nobody, I was very surprised. One of our, one of the ministers, in the, maybe education department or HR department, I don't remember. He said that these are not proven scientific theories and people were killing him almost in our present government. People can't even hear that because they don't want God the word anywhere. Simple. They think that that is very unscientific. Hence, anything that they can get to counter it, they put in. So this is another theory of that. We will see that in little detail. So natural selection is one Richard Dawkins takes as a big, big step. What it means to say in a simple term, nature selects those best suited species to survive. And the remaining which are not suited will die. For example, a black man and a white man comes to a place which is with great heat, the white man will die off because his skin is not, adaptive to a sunlight. He will have a skin cancer and he will die. And then the black man will survive because he has got a skin that can take this in. So thus, evolutionary principle happened and the best suitor has been selected and that's how it is happening. And he says that Darwin has found these marvelous things. Now you don't need to talk about how human beings have come about. This is there, all there. The way he puts it, no? Because it comes from scientists. We try and tend to believe it. Another scientist talked about Dawkins and said that nonsense, even if it comes from scientists, it's nonsense. So, okay, so this is absolute nonsense that without any evidences. Now, I want to delve a little more into this. First of all, he says that species has been naturally selected. And that's how the evolution advanced. So my first question here is, how did a new species have come? If two, a black man and a white man and came and white man died and black man survived, okay. But both are Homo sapiens. Both are same species. There is no new species that has been created. Absolutely no explanation for this in natural selection at all. How new species has created from monkey, how man has come about. Absolutely no explanation at all. Second one is, how did evolution progress upward if it is natural selection? First of all, natural selection says that it is a best suited one that has been selected. Okay. For example, there is a flood in a particular area and who will survive? Nature will select who? A frog that can swim, right? And a man who is a higher species, he will perish. Obvious, right? Natural selection has to be that way. I've just given an example, right? So, if that is what it is, now the same principle of evolution, if you apply to that, evolution says that species have grown from one to the other progressively. How that is possible? Because natural selection is not selecting the higher species. It is selecting the best suited species that could be of lower species also. Are you getting with me? Are you with me? It is contradicting each other. Natural selection and evolution of Darwin theory contradict each other here itself. Then also, you will see lower species still surviving and higher species extinct. You have this fellow? Higher species, right? Dinosaurus? Higher species, that's gone, extinct. Lower species, I had to call the pest control yesterday also to my home. Cockroach. That survived. So where is the evolutionary principle here? That it is progressing one to the other. That's contradicting itself. Then I apply the law of entropy. If the disorders are increasing in the universe, then the question again comes to the evolution. How is then it progressed? Is there a way that you can progress at all when the universe itself is not progressing? It is moving more and more disorder. Moreover, natural events happens randomly, isn't it? I mean, you don't get a calendar that where is going to be the flood in next 10 years, do you? It happens randomly here and there. If the selection nature does according to the random happenings of its events in this world, then how on earth evolutionary progression can ever happen? Are you with me? These are simple logical questions which Dawkins wouldn't bother to answer at all. It has no answer because there is no proof whatsoever for the Darwinian principles or Darwinian hypothesis, not even principle, hypothesis of evolution and natural selection. Much more than that. What would be the chart which is given here? Primates, from where it's evolutionary chart, okay? Primates, and then it moves to two prosimians and anthropoids. And under this, prosimians is coming the apes and chimpanzees and all, okay? So they are the cousins. They are not really from us, okay? Though you think that they are more closer, they are not. They are a little distance, okay? So under the other one, which is, there is a monkey that you can see, anthropoids. Okay, so that anthropoids, that's the monkey, the normal monkey that you see around. So those are the monkeys, comes under that anthropoids. And then from there is something called hominoids that has come. And from there, homo sapiens have come, which is including human, man, okay. So there are three categories there, we will talk about that. So man comes under this. Between anthropoids we have no doubt. Monkeys, we see monkeys. It's there, still there. Man, homo sapiens. All of you are. So no questions. But what about between these two? Where are the missing links? They are called connecting links. Okay? Connecting links. For example, a monkey which we all know, suppose he has a 1 meter tail. So according to evolutionary theory, that 1 meter tail has to first go to 0.99 meter tail. Then it has to become 0.98 meter tail. Then it becomes 97, 0.96, 96. It has to come down, and zero, and then man comes. This is how it happens. That means so many different connecting links should be there in each species. Each species, millions should be there. There are 10 lakh species in this world. So each species having millions and millions of connecting links. And each of these changes should take millions of years according to evolutionary theory. Are you with me? Hello? So that means you should be having billions of evidences all over the world. You just dig here for Rastomji building and you should have got some of these hominoids, don't you? Around the world you should have got everywhere, billions and billions. not a single one which is universally accepted in the scientific world has been found still now. It will numb your mind. These guys are simply lying. In the scientific world, not even a single missing link has been found. There has been many claims that these are missing links. For example, hominids fossils, there are three kinds. One is called Ramapithecus, the other one is Australopithecus, the third one is Homo erectus. All these are known. I mean, you know this in your schools. You must have heard these names in the school. So these are all called the different evolutionary process and different species. Now, Ramapithecus and Shivapithecus is interesting. As the name suggests, it's Indian. Rama and Shiva. it's supposed to have found in UP. Okay, that's why we are also there in the monkey place. So, but unfortunately, after a lot of research, it was proved that they are nothing but apes, which they have found. Whatever remains that they found was nothing to do with hominids. It's just an ape that they have found. Then the Australopithecus one, where they called something called Lucy and leaky skull, etc. All this has been found to be apes in the research. Come to Homo erectus fossils that you have. Homo erectus fossils also, you have something called Java man. Now that's interesting. Java man was found by Eugene Dubois. Now this man, what you did know? He picked up the skull. He picked up the skeleton. And there was a human skull also there, which he didn't take, nor he tell to anybody. He just picked up that skeleton alone and went into a research and big research that this is one of those missing links. Later found this particular skull of that man also was found in that place later, and the whole story was found to be a fake one. The other one is Peking man. He said that we have got a lot of bones of this man and two teeth of this man and etc. And when scientist calls for experimentation, he said that everything is lost but for two teeth. So what is left is two teeth that is being talked about. So that is also scientific world has put away. Then there was a Nebraska man. It was a tooth that they found, saying that this tooth is different from everything else. So this should be one of those missing links. And with the scientists, with the research, found that to be a tooth of a pig. These are there in scientific journals. It's not my stories. You can read it yourself. Pit down man was found to be a jawbone of an ape and a skull of a man put together. And this man called Arthur Smith has created this fake fossil. And interestingly, when he found this piltdown man and created with an ape skull and a body of a man, there was so much of research happened. Close to 500 people got their PhD on this man, on this fake stuff. And later it was found fake. Now come to man. There also you have this Neanderthal man, Cro-Magnon man, and modern man. Now these both, Neanderthal man as well as Cro-Magnon man, both found to be normal human beings, normal men. One of that is very interesting because Neanderthal man actually had a different leg. So that's how they thought this man would be. And with the research, they found that this man had a sickness called rictus sickness and deficiency of vitamin, and hence he had a little bit of trouble with his leg, and this is a normal human being. So that's how that has been found at all. And you come to modern man, that you and I, how different we are with our creativity, our consciousness, our moral principles, how different, fearfully and wonderfully the Lord has made us. Let me quickly go to this mutation explanation that he has, the fifth one. According to him, it's the mutation, the mechanism by which one species has gone to the next species. So this is what his argument is. So for this, couple of things that I want to ask in this. Mutation is nothing but the actual scientific evidenced one, whereby the UV or infrared lights or sometimes the chemical or chromosomes create some changes to the genes in the human beings. This is what basically mutation is. And that happens. You have this sickle anemia in the northern Kerala that you see, a lot of them, sickle anemia through mutation that is happening. Mutations is invariably always are destructive. It's never constructive. No evidence ever to suggest that mutations have created something progressive. It's always created destructive forces. How do you create progressively evolving evolution through mutations. If mutations is going to be destructive, all the time it comes back, 99% it come down, right? Then how do you ever create that progress at all? Even if it is, there is a 1% progress. So you have a 1% progress and 99% reverse. If you want to climb a mountain, 99 times you will come down and 1% you go up. How much you will climb up? You just won't climb up, right? So this principle doesn't make any sense at all. Even if there is a 1% growth possibility on a mutational system. Moreover, how much it requires for a mutation to change a species? Each of us has got more than 20,000 to 25,000 human protein coding within us, in our genes. Maximum mutation affects 5 or 10 of them, out of these 25,000 of them. How do you change a species by changing just 5 or 10 of them? And much more than that, how do you create a new species at all? For which they have come out with this beautiful experiment. This is the evidence for mutation. Okay, so this is called Biston Betuliria, which we see in school books as well. So what is this all about? So this is a kind of peppered moth, which has got dark color and a little light color. Two kinds of peppered moth. Okay, so scientific name is Biston Betuliria. Now they said that they found during the Industrial Revolution in England, the white moths have died off and extinct, and the dark moths have increased because of natural selection. Okay, so that was going on for a longer time till the same dark moths were found in the jungles of Scotland where there were no Industrial Revolution at all. Their argument was because of Industrial Revolution, the pollution was there, and so these dark ones, birds can't see and can't catch, and hence they developed. That was the argument. But what about the same dark ones in the Scotland jungles where there is no Industrial Revolution at all, and more danger for that particular being to be in that place? So this mutation doesn't hold water at all. All right, we have handled 5 of them. Now let me very quickly go through the evidences presented in the Christian worldview. Next 10 minutes and I will close with this. I will just present 4 of them to you. There are plenty. I can count almost 30 of them at least, which is intelligently available. At least 4 of them that I want to pick up and leave it with you. First of all, the rational intelligibility of the universe is an evidence that there is a rational being and intelligent which is behind this. Albert Einstein once said, the most incomprehensible thing in this world, in this universe, is that this universe is comprehensible. Which means with their mathematical modulations, they are able to comprehend this unbelievably incomprehensible world. And that's the beauty that we are talking about. This requires to agree that there is a rationality behind the universe and its law. What is mind? What is mind? Atheist explanation of a mind is, it's an unguided, mindless, meaningless particles dancing in your brain, which is again nothing but matters of physics and chemistry. That's what your brain is. So your thoughts are just a product of a mindless, unguided, randomly firing atoms in your brain. Wow. When Richard Dawkins tell that, I want to ask him. I don't get to see him, but I want to ask him. Then why do I buy your book, which is rational? There is no rationality in it. Mindless, unguided nonsense you are selling. Why? If you can't have rationality attributed to your own brain, your own thoughts, your own mind, why should I hear you? The rational, they are not agreeing to it, because if they agree to that, they have to agree to a rational intelligence behind the universe and God himself. And that's a big fact they are trying to escape from at all. Atheists also are people of faith. They also use mind and rationality occasionally. They also know universe is intelligible. And they also go into this faith of metaphysics, of rationality. You can't see your mind, right? Can you with experiments talk about your mind? Your thoughts, can you figure out what it is? Can you find out with your the love for your wife, your children, can you sort of get it in your lab? No? Are they real? Real. Can you see it? No. So means what? They are metaphysics, beyond physics. They are real and they are realities, which they also agree, the rationality. If that is what it is, my question is, how on earth rationality can come on to play with irrationality? Impossible. It is so much rational to believe that the universe is rational and intelligible, and there is a God who created this intelligible, rational universe on which I can do my science. It proves that God exists, who is uncaused, intelligible behind the scenes. Alvin Plantinga, he talked about Richard Dawkins in this, and he said, if Dawkins is right that we are the product of mindless, unguided natural processes, then he has given a strong reason to doubt the reliability of human cognitive faculties, and therefore inevitably to doubt the validity of any belief that they produce, including Dawkins. That's all that I said about it. So irrational intelligibility of universe is a telling proof that God exists. Then we have the second one, universal objective moral laws. Johnny touched upon it briefly. What is this? There is some moral laws. Universally we agree. If somebody gives a baby in your hands and you took a knife and trying to chop it, any culture in this world would say, that is barbaric, you can't do that. But my question is, how did this universal law came into being to call it not right? How did it come? It's very simple. There is a universal lawgiver who wrote that into the consciousness of human beings whom he has made in his own image. So we have in our conscience his law written on it, as Apostle Paul says it. And hence, there is a universal law that you can see in this. But you look at the UN, there is a difference between ought to and is. For example, the UN, when all the governments comes from all the cultures comes, on what basis they decide that this ought to be like this, this ought not to be like this? Because I'm coming from different cultures, something good for me is not good for you, so big. No. There is some standard ought to. It is different from what is in your culture. It is an ought to principle that is there and that we see across the globe. So, in this, if you look at it, evolution doesn't account this at all. Because a universal moral principle cannot be evolved through evolutionary principles at whatever that you can talk about. This proves that there is a God and there is a morality there, out there. I just given three pictures here. The one is of Gujarat riot. Whether you like it or not, and whatever party you are, you know that's wrong, annihilating a tribe. You look at Hitler out there. Even if Hitler would have won the world war and he has changed all your mindset, still you will say that what he did was wrong, annihilating Jews, innocent people. You look at Mao, who killed millions of people for his views, and you will say, anybody in the world would say, that was wrong. This is a universal moral principle transcending the cultures, and that proves and points as an evidence towards a transcendent moral law giver in God. And then I would like to put it to historical, third one, that is fine-tuning of the universe. If you really look at the fine-tuning of the universe, I have just given some, you have these notes with you. To have life sustained in this world, the amount of accuracy required by way of sunlight coming in, color of the sun, distance of the moon, distance of some stars, the oxygen content, even a small deviation if it happens, this earth will become inhabitable. Such an amazingly created universe this is. So finely tuned. impossible even mathematically to count the probability if that has to be created without any cause and chance. This points to that there is a God, there is an intelligent being behind the scenes. Former atheist Sir Fred Hoyle, he said this: common sense interpretation of the facts is that a super intelligence has monkeyed with physics as well as chemistry and biology, and that there are no blind forces in nature. He was the earlier atheist. Looking at this fine-tuned, he just couldn't take it at all. He felt there is some super intelligent being monkeyed in our physics, chemistry and biology and created this amazing world. Finally, historical evidences. Is Jesus a myth? Is resurrection a myth? As Paul said, if resurrection is a myth, my faith is of no value at all. So it is important, as I told about the law, if a murder happened, you can't go and kill that person and again take the proof. You need to find evidences. Was this person lived in history? Was this person died in history? And also you look at, was this person resurrected in history? What historians talk about the whole thing. I take one of the hostile historical books, I would say. It can't be called even historical book. A hostile book about Lord Jesus Christ, written by some Jews, which is called the Toledoth Jesu. It's a very hostile source. He didn't like Jesus at all. Talks all nonsense about Lord Jesus Christ. But he also agreed that this person was alive at this place. And he has died. They agree. It's a historical one. You have enough and more historians, not Christians. Historians telling this. You have Roman politician Pliny and Tacitus. You have Jewish historian Flavius Josephus. You have satirist Lucian. You have philosopher Celsus. So many historians talking about Lord Jesus Christ and talking about the hearsay that he has risen again. Jesus' resurrection was preached in the crime scene, Jerusalem, right in the first century itself. If that was a heresy, there would have been a lot of writings happening on that. You don't see that in the history at all. Rather, you have people saying that these guys are bribed and took the body away. That's the kind of theory that you hear. And is it logically possible when the Roman government, and these guys knew that there is a possibility of stealing the body, going and telling the governor that this could happen and that will be terrible. So the governor gives them the guard and the watch, and the entire Roman government watch guard standing there. Who is going to bribe and take the story? And if that is the story, that should have been evident in some way. And that should have been there in the history. No, you don't have that. He is risen. He is not there. C.S. Lewis said like this: no philosophical theory which I have yet come across is a radical improvement on the words of Genesis, that in the beginning God created the heaven and earth. God bless you.